Take this opportunity to thank my brothers and sisters in this community for this event and their first educational seminar in regards to the book of Samahat al-Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Abdullah bin Ibaz rahimahullah ta'ala, which is entitled Important Lessons for Every Muslim. And in this seminar, inshallah ta'ala, the brothers, they laid down the schedule. So inshallah, we're going to try to be organized and we're going to follow exactly what's in the schedule, inshallah ta'ala. As you see there, the first matter, the introduction. And I would like to speak about the superiority of knowledge. Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, He spoke highly about knowledge and those who carry it. For example, in Surah Ali Imran, Allah said, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. So in this particular ayah from Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He joined and He coupled His testimony that there is no deity worthy of worship except Him alone. His testimony, He coupled it alone with His angels and those who have been given knowledge. So the point of reference here is those who have been given knowledge. So that shows you the importance and the superiority of those who were given knowledge. And also in the Quran, every Friday, every Muslim and Muslima will read and we recite Surah Al-Kahf. And we come across the story of the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with Al-Khadir. And Al-Khadir, there is difference of opinion among the scholars whether he was a prophet or he was a righteous man, but regardless whether he was a prophet or a righteous man, the point is Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, even though he had noble qualification and merits, one of the five mighty messengers, and the one who was given the privilege to speak to Allah Azza wa Jal directly without the intervention of Jibreel. And even with all these qualities, when he heard, when Allah informed him about Al-Khadir, that he had some knowledge that Musa didn't have, he left everything and he traveled to Al-Khadir so that he can learn from him matters in regards to three affairs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us in the Quran. And we're not going to go through that now, but just the point is for you to see how important this matter is, that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he traveled and he had a very tedious journey. He said to his servant boy, لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِنْ سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبًا, that we have suffered a great deal of good, a great deal of fatigue in this journey of ours. And also you find out in the Quran itself that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to them, are those who have knowledge equal to those who don't have it? They're not going to be equal in the sight of Allah Azza wa Jal. And also, there are many ayat in the Quran But we're going to suffice with this ayat and also some of the ahadith from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in regards to the superiority of knowledge. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said in the sound hadith collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim on the authority from Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiyallahu anhu, that he said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ad-din. When Allah wish good for someone, he will grant him the understanding of the deed. Al-Shaykh ibn Ibaz rahimahullah ta'ala, and before him al-Imam al-Hafidh ibn Hajar in Fath al-Bari, he quoted some of the statements from one of the scholars. He said, if you see a man turning away, a man or a woman turning away from seeking knowledge, then you must know that Allah did not wish them good. Because if Allah wished them good, he would have granted them the fiqh, the understanding of the deen. And also you find out that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam also said, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم, that seeking knowledge is an obligation for every Muslim. وقال سهل بن عبد الله التستري رحمه الله تعالى الدنيا جهل وموات إلا العلم والعلم كله هباء إلا الإخلاص والإخلاص على خطر حتى يختم به. قال رحمه الله تعالى قال الدنيا جهل وموات إلا العلم والعلم كله حجة إلا العمل به والعمل كله هباء إلا الإخلاص والإخلاص على خطر حتى يختم به. سهل بن عبد الله التستري رحمه الله, he said that the life of this world is lifeless and useless except if it is coupled with knowledge, with the legislative knowledge taken from the Kitab and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said, and this knowledge is an argument against you if you don't put it to practice. He said, and the action itself is in a state of jeopardy unless you have sincerity when you do that action. We're going to suffice with this as far as the introduction, inshallah ta'ala, and we're going to move on to the explanation of Surah Al-Fatiha. As you know, this surah has other names, but the most common name is Al-Fatiha. And Al-Fatiha comes from the word Fataha Yaftahu. Fataha Yaftahu, when you open. Miftah is a key. Al-Fatiha is an opening chapter. Reason being, because when you open Al-Mus'haf, the first surah that you're going to see there is Surah Al-Fatiha. And Surah Al-Fatiha also has other names. Like for example, Al-Ulama, they mention, as you have studied, those brothers and sisters that studied in the book of Shaykh ibn Ibaz, important lessons, that al-ulama, they have called it, for example, al-shafiyah. That al-fatiha is a cure. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala an used to recite al-fatiha on people who were sick. And they used to be cured. طيب. So it can be used as a ruqiyah, as it is in the story of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they traveled to a village and they went to this village to take them as guests, and the people of the village they turned them down, and Allah decreed that the leader of that village, he was stung by a scorpion. So they tried everything to cure him, but nothing worked. So they said, what about those people that came to us and we rejected them as guests? Maybe they have something for him. So they went to the companions, radwanullahi alayhim, and the companions, radwanullahi alayhim, they said, we will, inshallah, cure him, but on condition that you give us a flock of sheep, which they agreed on. And then Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, he recited al-Fatiha on him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured him. And he got up as there was nothing wrong with him. So they went back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he informed him about the incident. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved of their action. And he said to them, give me a share of that flock of sheep. So that shows you here that it is permissible to seek a wage when you do ruqya. As long as the person, alhamdulillah, benefits from it. So also from the names of Al-Fatiha, al-ulama, they call it as-salat. As-salat. And the reason it is called salat because of the hadith Qudsi. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَسَّمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْفَيْنِ فَإِذَا قَالَ عَبْدِي الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي. So, in this hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have divided the salat. So he called it salat. طيب, he called it salat. So when the servant says, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, praise be to Allah, the Lord of the world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to him that my servant has praised me. طيب. So it is called the salat. And it is called also the pillar of the salat. Because as we know, ya ikhwan, brothers and sisters, maybe this should be a different class, inshallah, later on. But since it came up, we can benefit from it, that one of the pillars of the salat is the recitation of Surah al-Fatiha. As we know, that the salat has conditions. And the conditions of the salat, al-ulama, they mention, there are, how many, ikhwan, anybody knows? Nine. Nine conditions of the salat. The first one, al-Islam, that the person has to be a Muslim. طيب. So if a non-Muslim performs the salat, his salat will be invalid until he accepts al-Islam. He testified that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah and then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. طيب. So the first condition, barakallahu feekum, al-Islam. The person has to be a Muslim. The second one, the person has to be sane. In other words, an insane person, if he performs the salat, his salat will not be valid. Likewise, his fast would not be valid. And his hajj would not be valid. Because he doesn't have al-aql. He doesn't have the intellect. طيب. وَالْعَقْلُ مَنَاطُ التَّكْلِيفِ. Because in order for him to be responsible, he has to have the intellect. And he doesn't have that. طيب. So the second one, barakallahu feekum, al-aql. As a person has to be sane. The third one, you have to have intention. You have to have a niyyah. And Shaykh Sa'di rahimahullah ta'ala said, وَالنِّيَّةُ شَرْطٌ لِسَائِرِ الْعَمَلِ بِهَا الصَّلَاحُ وَالْفَسَادُ لِلْعَمَلِ. النِّيَّةُ شَرْطٌ is a condition for every action to be valid or invalid. So what is the scale? Is a niyyah, the intention. والنية شرط لسائر العمل بها الصلاح والفساد للعمل. طيب. Now after that, ya ikhwan, brothers and sisters, the fourth is maturity. So that child has to be mature. طيب, before that, he is encouraged to perform the salat. But he doesn't have to pray until he becomes mature. طيب. Now, I'm going to ask one of you to finish from what I left off, from the conditions of the salat. Can anybody finish? Who can finish? Nobody. Subhanallah, Allah musta'an. Okay, I'll finish, inshallah. طيب, we mentioned first one, al-Islam. Second one, sanity. Third one, intention. Fourth one, maturity. طيب. The fifth one, you have to be clean. Your body has to be clean, your clothes have to be clean, and the area where you're going to perform the salat has to be clean. So three parts, your body, your clothes, and the spot. Tayyib, that's number five. Number six, you have to have wudu. You have to have wudu. Tayyib, you have to have wudu. Tayyib. We're not going to go into other details. I'm just going in brief, inshallah ta'ala. You have to have wudu. Number six. Number seven, you have to cover your awra. You have to cover your awra. Naam? And we're not going to go into detail because this is not the lecture for that and the lesson for that. So, number 7, you have to cover your awrah. And number 8, the time of the salat has to be in. Na'am, you want to say something? Na'am? I didn't hear you.
He wants to answer a question.
He wants to answer the question? Okay, what's number 9? Now. Okay, I mentioned 8 now. What's number 9? La. 9. There's no 10, there's 9. Number 9. You have to face the Qibla. Okay? You have to face the Qibla. طيب. We're not going to go into the details and all that because this is not, but just to give you an example that Al-Fatiha is extremely important and it is a pillar in the Salat. So if someone, for example, by mistake, he skipped Al-Fatiha or she skipped Al-Fatiha in the Salat, then what should be done here? I'll give you an example. You have a man or a woman performing the Salat. They accidentally forgot to recite Al-Fatiha and they went into sujood. And then they remembered that they did not recite Al-Fatiha. What should be done here? Go repeat. What do you mean by go repeat it? Can you go into detail? Naam. What do you do? Naam. Yes, you go back up, you recite Al-Fatiha, na'am, and then you finish your Salat and you still have to do one more thing. What is it? Na'am, and then? Yeah, you're gonna finish, you're gonna do it all over again. You're gonna go back up, right? Recite Al-Fatiha, go into Rukur, go into Sujood, then now, there is one thing you have to do before you salam out. What do you have to do? Na'am, ahsant. You have to do 2 prostration of forgetfulness. Na'am, of forgetfulness. Tayyib. Okay, now, the second situation, this man or this woman did not realize until they went to the second rak'ah. Okay? Okay, what happened here? Can anybody answer? Anybody knows? Yes, correct. The second rak'ah becomes the first one. The first one is gone, finished. You see, here shows you the importance of Al-Fatiha. Na'am, because it's a pillar. Rukn min arkani salat. One of the pillars of the salat. Okay, the third situation, this person, he did not remember Naam. Until he salamed out. Okay, well, what they're supposed to do now? Naam. Fadal. Repeat the whole salat? Tayyib. Anybody has a different opinion or you all agree with the brother? Huh? Who agrees with the brother? Repeat the whole salat. Who say you agree with him? Okay. Tayyib, anybody else? Agree with the brother? Ikhwan. You agree with the brother or you disagree? Anybody who disagree here? Atfaddal. So that's it? Okay. Atfaddal. Repeat. Means you mean the whole salat or one unit? One unit. That's it? Okay, the person. Okay, let me repeat this to you, inshallah. That's why I told Brother Asad, question and answer would be better, inshallah. But listen, this person, he did not realize, or she did not realize, that the first rak'ah, na'am, they did not recite Al-Fatiha in that first rak'ah, or second, or third, or even the last one, right? Until they salamed out. They said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Then this person remembered. One unit. That's all he has to do. Repeat it. Does he have to do anything else besides that? Naam? What does he have to do? Sujood al-Sahw. You are, mashallah, you deserve a prize. You did very well. Everybody else, I'm sorry, you're incorrect. But the brother, mashallah, you got it right. Okay, in this case, as you have mentioned, jazakallah khair, that if you miss Surah al-Fatiha by mistake, طيب, and you salamed out, then you don't have to repeat the whole salat. Only that particular rak'ah and two sajdat al-sahw before you salam out. And that's it. طيب. Yes, go ahead. Recite, yes. No. Nah. When you salamed out. No. Nah. Okay, in that case, the timing is going to be too long. From Duhr, for example, to Asr. Okay, in that case, you repeat the whole salat. Okay, العلماء they say والعرف معمول به إذا ورد. Don't worry, I will translate. I know you don't know Arabic. العلماء they say والعرف معمول به إذا ورد حكم من الشرع الشريف لم يرد. Now when you have a situation, okay, like this, when you don't have an evidence from the Kitab and the Sunnah, like in regards to the time frame, Dhuhr and Asr, according to the custom, is too long. Right or wrong? It's too long. So in that case, you repeat the whole Salat. Even if you skipped Al-Fatiha in one rak'ah, and the timing was too long, then you have to repeat the whole Salat. But if the timing was short, then you repeat only that particular unit, na'am, plus to sajda of as-sahu before you salam out. Now, we continue inshallah with Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha comprises the three categories of Tawheed. Surah Al-Fatiha comprises the three categories of Tawheed. The first category, Tawheed Al-Rububiyyah, the unity of Lordship. Now, question for you, since you have studied the book, where is Tawheed Al-Rububiyyah in Surah Al-Fatiha? Can anybody tell me where is it? Where is the unity of lordship in Surah Al-Fatiha? Na'am. Maliki Yawm al-Din. Yes. And there is one before that. Alhamdulillah. Rabbil Alameen. The Lord of the World. This is also Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. طيب. Maliki Yawm al-Din is also Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Then the second category is Tawheed al-Ibaadah. Or if you wish, you can say Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Where is it in Surah al-Fatiha? Anybody knows? Yes. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Both of these is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Now question. What is the difference between Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah? Can anybody tell me the difference between them? Yes. Good. To expand on what you're saying, Jazakallah khair, correct answer, that Tawheed, the difference between Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah is the first one, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, is to single out Allah in His action. You single out Allah in His action, that He's the Lord, He's the sustainer, He's the provider, He's the one that sends down the rain, He's the one that caused someone to live and someone to die, and so forth, and so on, and so forth. طيب, this is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the mushrikeen of Quraysh didn't have an issue with it. They did not have any issue with Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Allah said in the Quran about them, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you were to ask them, O Muhammad, who created them, they would surely say, Allah. Then what is the problem? The problem is in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Because Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, you single out Allah out in your action as his servant and slave. So when you perform the salat, you perform the salat for Allah Azza wa Jal. When you make dua, you make dua to Allah. When you sacrifice to Allah. When you put your trust, you put trust on Allah. When you love Allah, and so on and so forth. Tayyib. Now, the mushrikeen of Quraysh, they worshipped Al-Lat, Wal-Uzza, Wa-Manat. And Al-Lat, Wal-Uzza, Wa-Manat, they were righteous people. But because of being excessive in their love and the like, this led them to using them as intermediaries. And this is what shirk is all about. So now, when you look at the past and the present, you're going to find out that shirk of today is worse than the shirk of the past. Because the shirk of the past, polytheism and ascribing partners with Allah Azza wa Jal, back then, al-mushrikeen, they committed shirk only at times of hardship, when they are in trouble. But the mushrikeen of today, they do it in ease, at time of ease and at a time of trouble. Hey, now, what is the connection between the two? At the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-mushrikeen, they worshipped Al-Lat wal-Uzza wa Manat and other idols. They used them as intermediaries. As Allah said about them in the Quran in Surah Yunus, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. That we worship them only to get us closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب. The mushrikeen of today, they worship Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jailani. And they worship Sayyid al-Badawi in Egypt. And Ahmed Bamba in Senegal. And other than that. نعم. And they call upon them, whether they are in trouble or they're not in trouble. And they use them as an intermediary. And this is what shirk is all about. Because in Islam, we don't have intermediary when it comes to worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah said in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ. When my servant asks you about me, I am close. I respond to the supplicator when he supplicates me. So there is no intermediary when it comes to the issues of ibadah. Yes, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explained the deen to the ummah. But when it comes to worshipping Allah azza wa jal, and you making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't use any intermediary. The third category of Tawheed, ya ikhwan, brothers and sisters, is the unity of Allah's names and attributes. The unity of Allah's names and attributes. Can anybody tell me what does this unity of Allah's names and attributes mean? Anybody can tell me? Anybody knows? Khalil, anybody? Naam? What does the unity of Allah's names and attributes mean? What does it mean? Yeah, come on. Permanent names of Allah. The attributes without making takyif or ta'til or tayyib. Okay, tayyib. The brother, he said, to affirm those names and attributes to Allah Azza wa Jal. Naam. Okay, now we have to understand what is affirm. Tayyib. Affirm is the opposite of negate. For example, Allah said in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, the most gracious, he rose over the throne. So we Ahlul Sunnah, we affirm this attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we say that Allah rose over the throne in a way that befits His Majesty. In a way that befits His Majesty. This is called what? Itbat. In Arabic, it's called Itbat. Itbat. affirming this attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said in the Quran, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا, and your Lord will come alone with the angels. So we say Allah will come in a way that befits His majesty. We affirm it and we don't negate it. طيب, negating the attribute is when you say that Allah does not come, but His affair will come. What is this called? This is called ta'wil. This is called what? Ta'wil. And if you wish, you can call it tahrif, distortion. Because Allah did not say His affair will come. He said He Himself will come. Ahlul Sunnah, we say and we affirm that Allah will come on Yawm Al-Qiyamah in a way that befits His majesty. Likewise, Allah mentioned that He has hands, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We affirm the hands to Allah. But the hands of Allah, they're not like our hands. Naam? And the face of Allah is not like our faces. And how Allah will speak is not like how we speak. Huh? We affirm these attributes as Allah affirmed them in the Quran and upon the tongue of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without, what the brother said, min ghayri tahreef, without twisting and distorting the meaning. طيب. ومن غير تعطيل, and without negating those attributes, without negating. ومن غير تشبيه, and without likening Allah to His creation. Okay? Now, the innovators from Al-Jahmiyyah, Al-Mu'tazila, Al-Asha'ira, Al-Maturidiyyah, Al-Kullabiyyah, and other than them, from the people, wal-iyadu billah, of ta'til, na'am, they don't affirm this attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They use al-majaz, metaphor. Na'am? They use metaphor. And they say that if we affirm the attributes, this would necessitate that we're going to liken Him to His creation. And we say to them, this is not correct, because Allah speaks in a way that befits His majesty. And we, the creation, we speak in a way that befits us. And the creator cannot be like the creation. طيب. So this is in brief the three categories of التوحيد. الشيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله, he said, من حقق التوحيد دخل الجنة بغير حساب. Whoever actualized التوحيد, he will enter الجنة without any accountabilities. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Al-Basmala in the Quran is mentioned in every surah except one surah, which is Surah Bara'a. That's the only surah in the Quran where Al-Basmala is not mentioned. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Now, if someone asked, what is the difference between the most gracious and the most merciful? Al-Ulama, they mention that the most gracious is comprehensive. It means that His mercy encompasses not only the believers, but the non-believers as well, and all of the creation. But Ar-Rahim is exclusively for the believers. As Allah said in the Quran, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا, and He is ever merciful towards the believers. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the world. So here, al-ulama, they mention that the statement of Allah, the Lord of the world, this necessitates that He is distinct from His creation. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not inside the world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His throne. As He said in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa, the most gracious rose over the throne in a way that befits His majesty. So al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His creation and is not everywhere. Like many of the people, when you ask them where is Allah, they say everywhere. This is very incorrect. Because when you say He's everywhere, this is very serious. Reason being, because when you say He's everywhere, this would necessitate that He's going to be in places that are filthy and dirty. And this does not befit His majesty, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمَا أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَىٰ. When he spoke to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and his brother Harun, he said, I am with you. أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَىٰ. I hear and I see. So that shows you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not physically with his creation. طيب. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم. And we spoke about that. مالك يوم الدين. And there is another recitation. مالك يوم الدين. And the difference between مالك and ملك. المالك is the owner. And the ملك is the king. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no doubt that he is the king and he is the owner. يوم الدين. The day of recompense. The day of recompense. As you see, I'm trying to be as simple as possible because the timing is long. So, and also we want to cover everything that is mentioned here, inshallah ta'ala. طيب. مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Here is توحيد الألوهية. توحيد الألوهية. Only you we worship. And only you we seek assistance from. But it doesn't necessarily mean that you cannot seek assistance from your fellow Muslims. You can ask someone, for example, to help you carry a suitcase if it's heavy. There's nothing wrong with that. But what's wrong is when you ask someone to do something for you, only Allah can do. Like for those ignorant Muslims in the Muslim world, unfortunately, that go to Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jailani, or Sayyid al-Badawi, or other than them from the so-called saint, and they call upon them to give them children, or to send down the rain or the light. This is shirk. Of course, these individuals are ignorant, they are to be taught. And the proof and evidence has to be established on them. طيب. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين إهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Guide us to the straight path. العلماء, they say, guidance is of two types. هداية الإرشاد وهداية التوفيق. طيب. The guidance of instructing and preaching and the like. And this is the job of the Prophet and messengers. And the callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they guide the people through instructing them and preaching to them and clarifying the message to them and the like. But it doesn't necessarily mean that all of them will be guided. طيب. The second guidance is the guidance of success. And this one only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has control of. No one else. And that's why Allah said in a surah, He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتِ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're not going to be able to guide the one you love. Only Allah guides. Means the guidance of success. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Guide us to the straight path. Then what is the straight path, ya ikhwan? This is very important, brothers and sisters. Allah says in the Quran, in another surah, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. And that this is my straight path. So follow it and do not follow other path because they will mislead you away from the path of Allah. Then, what is this Sirat al-Mustaqim? As-Sirat al-Mustaqim is the path of those that Allah showered His bounty and blessing upon. Because He said, Sirat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim. Clarify that. Then who are they? The prophets. The prophets and messengers, peace be upon them. Na'am. And then as-siddiqun, like Abu Bakr as-siddiq and his daughter Aisha and the like. And also as-shuhada, the martyrs. And also as-salihun, the righteous. Now, Allah said in Surah An-Nisa, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى. وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in this ayah, the meaning of which, that whoever opposes the messenger, the messenger is specifically Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever opposes the messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after guidance has been clarified to him, that shows you that someone is not required until the proof is established on him. So he said here, مِن بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى. After guidance has been clarified to him, and it follows a way other than the way of the believers. Okay. Ulama al-Tafsir, the scholars of Tafsir like Ibn Kathir and others, they say the believers here, it is intended to be specific. Because in the principle of jurisprudence, you have al-Aam. Al-Aam, which is the general. Like for example, Allah said in the Quran, والعصر إن الإنسان الإنسان لا في خسر. By the time men, okay, here in the Arabic language, الإنسان has ألف and لام. And الألف and لام in the Arabic language can either mean it is general or it is specific. طيب, like for example, ومن يشاقق الرسول. Whoever opposes the messenger is specific. Because the messenger here is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But here, na'am. But here he said, in al-insana, mankind. This is general. It includes men, women, children, all mankind. Muslims, non-Muslims. Tayyib ya ikhwan. Tayyib. Now, going back to that, he said, "من يشاقق الرسول من بعد ما تبين له الهدى ويتبع غير سبيل المؤمنين." Whoever opposes the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam after guidance has been clarified to him, and he follows a way other than the way of the believers, even though the believers is general, but is intended to be specific. Who are the believers here? The companions. Ridwanullahi alayhi. He could have said, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى. Huh? He could have said that. But why would Allah Azza wa Jal put that restriction there? Why? Because this deen was carried out to us by the companions. They're the one that passed down this religion. That's why you find out Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, and he memorized more than 5,000 hadith, 5,374 hadith. And you find Aisha radiallahu anha, Anas ibn Malik, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, and Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and many of the companions, they carry this knowledge to us. So they are the students of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they learned this deen from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they are our model. They are the best example for us to follow. And that shows you right there that it is not enough to follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and not to follow his companions or ridwanullahi alayhi. And this is gonna come. It is in this ayah. وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى. It's a threat. He said, we will leave him in that path that he had chosen. And we would lead him in the fire, and what an evil destination. So that shows you the obligation of following the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi. In the hadith of the Messenger of Allah, he clarified. And when you look at the hadith and the ayah, you're not going to find no conflict between the hadith and the ayah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَسَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي عَلَى 73 فِرْقَةٍ كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٍ قِيلَ مَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ مَنْ كَانَ عَلَى مِثْلِ مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمِ وَأَصْحَابِي. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and my ummah, my followers, will be divided into 73 sects. All of it will be in the fire except one. They said, which one is this, O Messenger of Allah? He said, those who are upon what I am upon today and my followers. That shows you that we have to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions ridwanullahi alayhim. And when Abdullah ibn Umar, he was asked about the Muslim community. He was asked about the word jama'ah. What is jama'ah? Because a lot of people, they have this misconception about the word community. So when you ask anyone what is community, say, oh, a large of people, a large body of people. It's not always the case. It's not always the case. Because when you look at Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, how many years did he call his people to Tawheed? 950 years. How many followers? Some of the scholars, they said seven only. Seven followers. So they were a jama'ah. Everybody else was condemned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them. And that's why Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas, he said, the sunnah is like the ark of Noah. Whoever embarks upon it, he will reach safety. Whoever refused, he will drown. Wallahi. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, he was asked about al-jama'ah. He said, Abu Bakr and Umar are al-jama'ah. Abu Bakr and Umar, that's it. And they kept asking about the other generation until he came to a man called Abu Hamza al-Sukkari. He said, Abu Hamza al-Sukkari is the community by himself and those who are with him. So that shows you, Akhwan, brothers and sisters, is that the real consideration is not in numbers. But the real consideration is following the truth and sticking to it, even if those who follow it are few. قال الإمام الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله تعالى. I want you to memorize this statement of الفضيل بن عياض. I heard it many times from our noble Sheikh عبيد الجابري حفظه الله تعالى. قال الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله تعالى: عليك بطرق الهدى ولا تستوحش من قلة السالكين. وإياك وطرق الضلال ولا تغتر بكثرة الهالكين أو الجاهلين أو كما قال رحمه الله. الفضيل بن عياض رحمه الله تعالى, he said, one of the exemplary imams of Al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah, he said that stick to the path of guidance even if the followers are few. Even if those followers are few. And be aware of the path of misguidance, even if the followers are many. And do not be deceived by the multitude of the ignorance. And that's why you see moths. When they see a light, what do? They rush to it, right? And when they see fire, what do? They rush to it and they are destroyed. So the number doesn't mean anything. Unless it is coupled with the Kitab wa Sunnah and the understanding of our righteous predecessors, Ridwanullahi alayhi. There was a question here about al-ibadah. Al-ibadah, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, ismun jami' likulli ma yuhibbuhu Allahu wa yardah min al-aqwali wal-af'ali al-dahirati wal-batinah. Hadhihi al-ibadah. Very beautiful explanation of al-ibadah. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said al-ibadah, this word ibadah, worship, is a comprehensive term that comprises everything that Allah loves and is pleased with. From the actions that are internal and the actions that are external. Okay, the actions that are internal is al-iman, the belief of Allah, the love of Allah, tawakkul ala Allah, and so on and so forth. These are internal actions. And the external action, as-salat, al-hajj, and other than that, those ibadah that are physical. طيب. And the ibadah will not be called ibadah unless it meets two conditions. The first, al-ikhlas, sincerity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. And they were not commanded except to worship Allah Azza wa Jal in sincerity. So that shows you the importance of ikhlas, sincerity. The second condition, that ibadah has to be in compliance with the Sharia, the Islamic law. And this is from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah said in the Quran, "Am lahum shuraka shara'u lahum min ad-din ma lam ya'dan bihi Allah." Do they have partners that legislated for them that which Allah did not permit? This is very serious. That shows you the danger of innovation in the religion. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, "Inna al-bid'ata ahabba ila Iblis min al-ma'siyah." المعصية يتاب منها والبدعة لا يتاب منها. This is in مجموع الفتاوى. That Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, indeed innovation is more beloved to shaitan than the sin. Because the sin, when you commit a sin, you feel guilty. And you want to repent. But when you commit an innovation, you believe this is from the deen. And not only that, you start calling the people to it. وَلَيَّادُ بِاللَّهِ. This is the danger of innovating. وقال الإمام أبو زرعة الرازي رحمه الله تعالى سيئات أهل السنة خير من حسنات أهل البدع. أبو زرعة رحمه الله, he said the sins of the people of the Sunnah are better than the good deeds of the innovator, because أهل السنة they are not infallible, but they are on the right path. But the people of innovation, they may pray قيام الليل. They may do this, they may do that. طيب, but they are upon what? Misguidance. And their actions are rejected. And they precede in Allah and His Messenger. And that shows you right there the danger of innovating in the religion. So in order for al-ibadah to be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal, it has to meet two conditions. The first one, al-ikhlas, sincerity, that you do in this deed for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And you're not intending fame. You're not intending anything like a show off or something like that. The second condition, barakallahu feekum, brothers and sisters, that action has to be in compliance with the kitab was sunnah. Amen.